Hello all, welcome to the session of Management Principles and Applications, and today we'll discuss leadership styles. So what are leadership styles? Leadership styles refers to leader's behavior. How does he behave and how does he act to lead the people? So the various patterns of behavior favored by leaders during the process of directing and influencing workers, because we've already seen that leadership is all about influencing, stimulating the workers as well as directing. So how does he do that? What kind of behavior patterns can we see in particular leadership style is what this presentation is all about. So it is the result of leader's philosophy, personality, experience, and value system. Also, we have seen the factors affecting the leadership, and they very well go with the leadership styles or a leadership style a leader follows. It's his inherent philosophy or what kind of personality he is. He's an introvert or an extrovert. How much experience does he has and what kind of value system he shares. All depends, the leadership style depends on all of these. So, and also it depends on the type of followers in the organization. What kind of followers are there? So external factors are also there. Different leadership styles recognized in management literature are authoritarian style of leadership, democratic style of leadership, free Ryan, paternalistic style of leadership, strategic leadership, transformational leadership, transactional leadership, coach style leadership, and bureaucratic leadership. Now, authoritarian, it is also known as autocratic leader. He gives orders which he insists shall be obeyed. He determines the policies for the group on his own and tells the group to implement it. He gives personal praise or criticism to each member on his own initiative and remains aloof from the group for the major part of time. The leader who adopts this style is of the opinion that decision making is his prerogative to decide and order subordinates' obligation to do what they told to carry out. He does not give the subordinates the freedom to influence his behavior. So he's all about authority. He has the authority. He believes that he has the authority to direct people. And it's kind of a little bossism that comes in, right? And this style of leadership is subdivided into two categories, oppressive or dictator style, benevolent or autocratic style. Now, oppressive or dictatorial, you know what are dictators? Hitler was a dictator, right? So the leader influences subordinates through negative motivation. That is, he carries out decisions through fear, threats, punishments, penalties, etc. So the leader is vested with unlimited powers, and his relationship with subordinates consists of doing what they are told without questioning their superior, right? And in the second case, that is the benevolent autocratic style, he emphasizes on task orientation. So he is concerned about tasks. So these leaders takes into consideration the wishes, feelings, and the needs of subordinates as assessed by the leader in spite of leader's unlimited powers, right? So autocratic leader is going to exercise complete control over the subordinates, though it can be, the degree may vary, so from oppressive to benevolent. And he dominates and drives his group through maybe coercion or even command, and he loves power and never delegates the authority. So the leader gives orders and expects the subordinates to follow them without any question. He uses rewards and holds threats of penalties to direct the subordinates. So what are the various features in authoritarian leadership style? He delegates little authority. So he doesn't delegate much. then he exercises close supervision. He doesn't give the freedom for people to work. So, you know, he exercises proper control. And he is the one who is going to make all the decisions. And he gives very detailed instructions and directions so that there is a little scope of autonomy. Then subordinates' suggestions and ideas are not sought or considered. So, you know, they're not welcome to tell you what can improve the performance or what is happening, because he's going to take all the decisions on his own. And he uses coercion as a mean for getting the job done. And he emphasizes on production or task that, you know, we have to do this. So there is a single goal that the output should be the maximum. And he permits little or no initiative to subordinates. So, you know, there is no motivation for subordinates to take initiatives, because everything, all the responsibility and credit is of the leader, authoritarian leader. The merits of this style: it facilitates quick decision making. Yes, and it provides motivation and satisfaction to whom? Of course, to the leader. It ensures smooth and disciplined functioning. So, because there are no loose ends, everything is under close supervision of the leader. So, hence, you know, the work goes smoothly and in a disciplined fashion. It succeeds where subordinates are incompetent and they are reluctant to take initiatives. So, in case of unskilled or poorly skilled followers, it succeeds because, you know, subordinates do not want to take initiative, or they are incompetent enough to take those initiatives. So, you know, autocratic leadership style permits quick decision making because he's the one who's making the decisions, right? And so all these are the merits of authoritarian leadership. Then we come to demerits. Employees dislike this when the motivational style is negative. So, you know, so the motivation is negative, punishment, right? So they are not going to like it. So autocratic style, it may lead to frustration, low morale, and conflict among subordinates, right? It may affect the organizational efficiency also, and subordinates may start shirking the responsibility and initiative. And a full potential of subordinates and their creative ideas are not being utilized. It's only the you know, the competency of leader which will determine the projects or organization's success, and not the followers' ideas and skills. Also, organizational continuity is threatened because of this, because in the absence of leader, the subordinates do not know, or they do not have an experience to, you know, carry on the operations, and they haven't got any opportunity for development. So, you know, so the continuity of the organization is in so much danger in case of authoritarian leadership style. Where it is suitable? It is suitable in the crisis situation when you have to take quick decisions and you do not want any conflicts. Then yes, in the crisis situation, it should be one person autocratic style. Okay, we'll go this way, right? And it is suitable for those who are untrained and incompetent, as I have told you already, and they know better way of managing. So unskilled people, they you know, like to be directed. So, and then it is suitable to those who are self-centered and need such a style in order to feel important. So it is suitable for those leaders who are self-centered, and, you know, the power, it benefits them, it brings out the best in them, and they feel important. So those people, they generally look for the authoritarian leadership style. Also, to those who creed authoritarianism. So, you know, there are people who think that, you know, this is the only way to direct people. So autocratic leadership style, it may be appropriate when subordinates are uneducated, unskilled, and submissive, lack of knowledge and experience on the part of subordinates. So, you know, in that case, leader would be taking his own decisions. And this is also desirable when the company endorses fear and punishment as accepted disciplinary techniques. So culture ही है कि disciplinary action हो जाएगा and everybody is fine with it. So then you go in for the authoritarian leadership style. And when a leader prefers to be dominant in the decision making and there is little room for error in final accomplishment, autocratic leadership may enhance morale and improve productivity also. But you know, these days autocratic style is becoming very less desirable because employees are becoming more educated and well organized. Now we come to democratic style. So other name for this style is participative style. So people would participate in. A democratic leader is the one who gives orders only after consulting the group and makes decisions after deliberations within the group. So the leader is conscious of the fact that praise or blame is a matter for the group and participates in the group as a number. His decisions are not unilateral and he exercises control mostly by using forces within the group. So it is a kind of a consultative or a democratic style of leadership where all the decisions are taken in the consultation and with the participation of the subordinates. So he decentralizes authority and allows the subordinates to share his power. And also the leader does what the group wants and follows the majority opinion. So every time there is a vote and the majority wins, he keeps the followers informed about matters affecting them. A democratic leader provides freedom of thinking and expression also. He listens to the suggestions, grievances, and options of the subordinates. So this is a very, very participative style of leadership. What are the various features? He delegates authority and responsibility. He manages through objectives. So he creates objectives and then let people think about how to achieve those objectives without really directing them towards it. Then permits initiative and responsibility. And then he wants the other people to take the initiative and be responsible for their actions and ideas and getting credit for it as well. So so they should feel that they're part of that project or that organization and they own it as well. Then seeks and encourages employee suggestions. So he understands that one person cannot know everything and there are other people. So, you know, if two minds are working, it's 1 + 1 becomes 11 and not only 2. So, you know, he encourages employees to give suggestions and new ideas and with their experiences so that the organization can benefit from that. Then it engages in participative decision making. Of course, we have talked about it. So all the participation of most of the employees would ensure that the decisions taken are taken very seriously and you know, they are realistic also, so that organization doesn't have to revisit its goals and objectives again and again. So the strategies would actually lead to the goals. Because they would be realistic and participative decision making is going to make it easier. Then emphasizes production and employee satisfaction. Authoritarian, he was only emphasizing on production. He was not concerned with the employees. So, but in democratic style, they consider that employee behavior is important, employee satisfaction is important, and hence they should take care of it and they shouldn't let them be dissatisfied and keep them motivated. Also, based on the assumption that the leader drives his power by the consent or followers who are mature and creative. So, the more mature and creative the followers would be, their ideas, when the leader will hear them out and would adopt them as well, it would increase the respect for that leader in the followers, and they would follow him even better, and it would, you know, he can be a role model for all others because they are very appreciative of the democratic style of the leader. Now, merits. It facilitates dynamism in the organization. So organization becomes very dynamic. Everywhere ideas are flowing, creativity is flowing, and you know, the center stage is held by the objectives or goals, and everybody is working towards it with in his or her own capacity. So it becomes a very dynamic organization. It provides attitudes of employees towards the jobs and the organizations. So it improves the attitudes of the people, because now they feel related to it. So there is a job satisfaction, there is some commitment towards the organization. So, you know, it's also the overall attitude of the people would be better in case of a democratic style. It facilitates better understanding between management and employees and promotes their cooperation. So they wouldn't think that, you know, the management is acting as a boss and our suggestions are not welcome. So there would be a misunderstanding, there can be a misunderstanding in case of an authoritarian style, but in democratic style, the understanding between employees and management is very good, and you know, every decision is being taken by you know, everybody virtually, and so it is going to promote the cooperation among the employees in the organization. Then it improves employee morale and minimizes complaints. Yes, they will feel motivated, employees will feel motivated and will feel the part of the organization, because they have that authority to take few decisions in the organization. And this would actually, even if you bring a change in the organization, they would know that why is it there, and in long term it is going to help the organization as well as them. So there would be very less complaints in a democratic style. And then lastly, it facilitates the development of future leaders. So the continuity of the organization is not threatened, because you have given ample opportunities for others to grow and develop and take responsibilities, take initiatives, and so your future leaders would come up among yourselves if your leader has been a democratic leader. So as such, in democratic style, it improves the job satisfaction and morale. It cultivates decision-making capability of subordinates. And the leader multiplies his abilities through the contribution of his followers. So his thinking, now he was only, once he was thinking only as one mind, but now if 10 people are there, so there is the effect of synergy that, takes place. And the quality of decisions also gets improved. Labor absenteeism and labor turnover are reduced. And, overall it brings the positive attitude, and it reduces the resistance in the employees. So it is a beautiful environment when it is a democratic style of leadership prevailing in an organization. Then we come to demerits of the democratic style. So, there is a possibility for delayed decisions and deliberations are of dilatory nature. So everything gets dilated when it goes to the masses. When one person is making a decision, it is quick and easy. You can imagine that, in your house, if everybody takes the decision that what would be cooked in the dinner, then at least half an hour would be spent on deciding that what would be cooked. Rather, if there is one person, your mother or your father, who's taking the decision that, okay, this would be today's menu in the dinner, it just takes few seconds, right? So, similarly, in organizations, there would be delayed decisions if the decision-making authority is with so many people. Then, participation of employees will not be complete and purposeful unless or otherwise employees understand thoroughly the complex problems of the organization. So, participation is not only that, you know the problem and you've given the solution. You have to understand it in a bigger manner. So, if you've given the autonomy to a person who's a supervisor, can only see his side of things. He cannot view overall organization. So this is a drawback or a constraint of those people who are you know, in that situation. So the top management has to you know, oversee everything and provide the all the employees with the overall vision of the organization in order to avoid this problem. Then it is not liked and suitable to employees who want minimum interaction with superiors and colleagues. So, you know, not everybody is an extrovert. There are introvert people there who want to do their work and, you know, go out of the organization and leave it there. So they would not like to socialize and run around every time on to take a decision in a participative style. So, you know, so for those employees, it would be a challenge. And then it may be used to manipulate the employees. So, you know, you can influence the people by posing that, you know, they are taking the decision, but it's something like, you know, the top management has decided long back. So, for example, if let us say they have thought of shutting down a unit of the organization, and they go to those people and tell them that, you know, this is the problem, we are making so many losses and the organization's existence would be threatened, which is not the case, and the other units are really doing well. So then employees will think, okay, maybe, you know, yes, we should close it down, and even if 50% of us gets absorbed, at least 50% would be at advantage. So this way the top management can actually manipulate the employees through this style of leadership. So this was all about democratic leadership style. Now we come to free rein leadership. Now what is free rein? As you know, so everybody is free to take the decisions, right? So free rein leadership involves complex delegation of authority so that subordinates themselves take the decisions. So the free rein leader avoids power and relinquishes the leadership position. He thinks that everybody is same and people can take their own decisions. So he serves only as a contact to bring the information and resources needed by the subordinates. So also, so in the case of free rein leadership, what is the other name? Permissive style of leadership or laissez-faire style. All these two names are for free rein leadership. In this case, the leader not only leads but leaves all responsibility for most of the work to his subordinates. So the free rein leader avoids power. He depends largely upon the group and work out its own problems. Group members work on their motivation, and the manager exists as a contact man for outsiders. So the leader completely abdicates its leadership position. It lets it go and let other people decide for themselves. Now, what are the features? It is directionless. So, you know, anybody can go in any direction because leader is not there to keep them roped in. It emphasizes neither production nor employee satisfaction. So it is like, I have left you on your own. You want to do it, you please do it. If you don't want to do it, please bear the consequences on your own, right? So employees are allowed to drift also. So employees can drift apart. They can think of, they can decide on their own what is good for organization, what is good for them, align their personal interests with the organization. And, you know, it just goes like that. And what are the merits of this laissez-faire? It motivates and improves the morale of employees by giving maximum freedom to them. So, you know, now if you know that you are the whole soul of the thing, and your decision is going to change the future of the organization, how responsible will you become, right? So, so there is going to be, you know, positive effect on job satisfaction and morale of the subordinates. And so there is full utilization of the potential of the employees or subordinates, because the subordinates are given the maximum opportunity for development, right? So, you know, they are into maximum possible scope for development. And these are the merits. But what are the demerits? It permits the emergence of informal leaders. So because there is no formal leader there, people would look up to somebody and it would sprout informal leaders. And subordinates, because you know they are not getting the guidance and support of the leader, this will become a norm here. Then the group is deprived of the leader's inspired motivation, guidance, and socio-economic support. It ignores manager's contribution completely. So, you know, it's like leader's contribution is ignored it is same as autocratic. In autocratic style, subordinates' contribution is ignored. In leadership, in free Ryan, the leadership contribution is completely ignored, which are not very desirable things. Also, subordinates may move in different directions and may work at cross purposes, which may degenerate into chaos. So, you know, they do not know where to go, what is the bigger plan, and people might act in, in the negative of the organization while working on their parts. Also, this can succeed only when the subordinates are highly competent and self-motivated. So now this is also very important that, in case of somebody who needs complete freedom, he doesn't want any boss, this is the ideal kind of leadership. And for example, these are the artists and more creative people like this kind of free Ryan leadership. So it is a style that is appropriate when the subordinates are very well trained and highly knowledgeable, and they are very, very self-motivated and are creative and full of ideas and ready to assume the responsibilities. So all those people would like to be in the free Ryan leadership. Now, paternalistic leadership. Now this approach, it tries to strike a balance between work-centered approach and consideration for subordinates. So the leader tends to look after subordinates the way a father does to his family. So he would be there looking after, he would listen to them also to some extent, but would take his own decisions, and he's going to help, guide, protect, and keep the followers happily working together as members of a team. So they insist on group performance. The leader provides the employee with good working conditions, fringe benefits, welfare facilities, health facilities, and so many other services. Because, he owns them, he cares for them. So this is the paternalistic leadership, which falls between work is important, but for him, the subordinates are also very important. What are the merits? Employees prefer this approach. Who doesn't want to be, taken care of? Everyone wants the care and affection. The motivation and cooperation of the employee is considered good, and in this case he would be very motivated to work. So many a times it's like you don't want to study and then you think that my father would be very happy when he'll see my mark sheet, or that he would be very proud. So it keeps you motivated. Similar way, the employee, if he feels that the leader is the father figure and he's going to be really happy with the success of the subordinate, so it would give him another level of motivation to work. And he will also cooperate with the other employees. But what is the main criticism of this paternalistic leadership is that it is the realization on the part of employees that they work and exist in the organization in their own right and not out of employer's gratitude. So they can take it for granted which is not desirable in case for the organization, because the organization wants that they should understand their role. It is only the care is being provided by the leader because he feels that they would be more motivated. But if it affects negatively or they do not feel motivated, then this paternalistic leadership becomes a problem. Then strategic leadership. This is commonly very effective leadership actually. So what is it? It is strategic leaders sit at the intersection between a company's main operations and its growth opportunities. He or she accepts the burden of executive interests while ensuring that current working conditions remain stable for everybody else. Now, this is desirable leadership style in many companies because strategic thinking supports multiple types of employees at once. However, leader who operate this way can set a dangerous precedence with respect to how many people they can support at once. And what is the best direction for the company really is if everyone is getting their way at all times. So in what is a strategic leadership? When you have the common interest in your heart and you are strategically working and, you know, making everything stable. And so the leader has certain strategies to get the work done, right? And it doesn't suit when the people doesn't want those strategies. They want to work in a little autonomy. Then the strategic leadership becomes a problem. Otherwise, it is a very effective way of motivating and influencing the people to work. Then we come to transformational leadership. It is effective sometimes. So what is transformation leadership? It is always about transforming, changing, improving upon the company's conventions. Employees might have a basic set of tasks and goals that they complete every week or month, but the leader is constantly pushing them outside their comfort zone and is making them grow. So a transformation leader is the one who provides individualized consideration, intellectual stimulation, and possesses that charisma. So the transformation leaders are those who, through personal vision and energy, inspires their followers and exercise a major impact on their organizations. Such leaders are also known as charismatic leaders. So occasionally a leader emerges whose personal charisma catches people's attention, and support charisma is a leadership trait. It means interpersonal attraction of a leader that inspires acceptance and support from the people. Highly charismatic leaders are more successful than those without charisma. So Narendra Modi has a charisma, has an aura of his own that people, not only from India, but entire world wants to follow him. So the leader's charisma inspires people to work extra because they like the leader and enjoy working under him. So Swachh Bharat Abhiyan or anything. So he gives you a motive. In COVID, we all were banging the plates, or we were lighting up the candles, which otherwise we wouldn't have done. But it was his charisma that he was insisting, and we all did it and happily did it. So this was the concept of transformation leadership. It was introduced by James M. Byrne and Bass. And, so they have identified certain characteristics of transformation leaders, and they are like idealized influence. So a transformation leader serves as a role model. And then inspirational motivation, that the transformation leader articulates a vision that is appealing and inspiring to the followers. So they are challenged with high performance standards, optimism, and meaningful tasks. So they develop a strong sense of purpose, which provides them energy and derives their performance. And then it gives this transformation leadership gives intellectual stimulation. So it challenges the existing assumptions of, you know, taking risks, soliciting the ideas of the followers. And then he encourages creativity and nurtures followers to think independently. For him, learning is a value, and unexpected situations are seen as opportunities to learn. So the more, unknown the environment is, the better opportunities you have. And then individualized consideration, which includes that, you know, the leader attends to the needs and concerns of all the followers, acts as a mentor with empathy and provides support, keeping open communication. And he celebrates the contribution of each follower. As a result, the followers aspire for self-development and have intrinsic motivation for work. So, when starting a job with this type of leader, all employees might get a list of goals to reach as well as deadlines for reaching them. While the goals might seem simple at first, these managers might pick up the pace of deadlines or give you more and more challenging goals as you grow with the company because they want you to develop. Now, this is highly encouraged form of leadership among growth-minded companies because it motivates employees to see what they are capable of. But transformational leaders can risk losing sight of everyone's individual's learning curve of direct report, don't receive the right coaching to guide them through the new responsibilities. Now we come to transactional leadership. Now, what is transactional leadership? Transactional leadership is are fairly common these days because these managers reward their employees for precisely the work they do. A marketing team that receives a scheduled bonus for helping generate a number of leads by the end of the quarter is a very common example of transactional leadership, right? So in this transactional leadership, the leader determines what subordinates need to do to achieve objectives, clarifies the task requirements, and helps subordinates become confident that they can achieve this objective. So the leader offers rewards to the subordinates who accomplish the tasks assigned to them. The focus is on achieving results and clarifying the role of subordinates, right? And the transactional leader is the one who guides and motivates the followers in the direction of established goals by clarifying role and task requirements. Now, transactional leadership involves exchange relationship between the leader and his followers. It is a transaction based. So in this relationship, the leader promotes unity by providing fair extrinsic rewards, appealing to the intrinsic motivation of the collaborators and developing their transcendent motivation. Right? So it sets goals for subordinates and motivates them to achieve them. Also, it lays down work standards and evaluates subordinates' performance against those standards. Also, it offers rewards to subordinates for their good performance. So in transactional leadership, it helps establish roles and responsibilities for each employee, but it can also encourage bare minimum work if employees know how much their effort is worth all the time. So this leadership style can use incentive programs to motivate employees, but they should be consistent with the company's goals and used in addition to unscheduled gestures of appreciation. So it is a transactional leadership where they transact the followers and the leader transact between each other for the motivation and the goal setting. Now, coach style leadership. It is commonly effective. What does a coach do? He coaches you, he tells you what is good for you and then leave you to play, right? So similarly to a sports team coach, this leader focuses on identifying and nurturing the individual strengths of each member on his or her team. So they also focus on strategies that will enable their team work better together. So this style offers strong similarities to strategic and democratic leadership, but puts more emphasis on the growth and success of individual employees. So rather than forcing the employees to focus on similar skills and goals, these leaders might build a team where each employee has an expertise or skill set in something different, right? In a cricket team, so one is a goalkeeper, a bowler, a batsman, a fielder. So all have different capabilities and a team is set. So in a similar fashion, the coach style person would make a team where people have different positives and strengths, and so that they can work as a team and give you the best out of whatever they have out of the existing resources. So in the long run, this leader focuses on creating strong teams that can communicate well and embrace each other's unique skill sets in order to get the work done. So a manager with this kind of leadership style might help employees improve on their strengths by giving them new tasks to try. So he would not refrain from giving them new challenges and then he'll offer them guidance also or meeting to discuss constructive feedback. So he would often call the meetings and for the feedback, and a constructive one where genuine ideas come into play and they can work for the organization's best. Then they might also encourage one or more team members to expand on their strengths by learning new skills from other teammates. So this can also happen that, you know, in the team, you can keep switching the roles. So, you know, you can become an all-rounder in cricket when you know batting, bowling, as well as fielding. So, you know, the same way in organization, you can, this kind of leader, the coach-style leader, can prepare people to work in different fields and get the experience and knowledge of all the related fields as well. So that there is a continuity in the process or in the department or in the organization. Then we come to bureaucratic leadership. It's really effective. But what is it? Bureaucratic leaders go by the books. So this style of leadership might listen and consider the input of employees, unlike autocratic leadership. But the leader tends to reject an employee's input if it conflicts with company's policies or past practices. So he would check. So he has a checklist from the past or a book or a rule book, you can say. So if there are certain ideas coming from people, he would see that if there is a precedence, yes, there is a precedence, he would go for it. If there is not, then he would go by the books and reject it completely. So he can become an autocratic leader as well. So you may run into a bureaucratic leader at a large, older or traditional company. At these companies, when a colleague or employee proposes a strong strategy that seems new or non-traditional, bureaucratic leaders may reject it completely. Their resistance might be because the company has already been successful with current processes and trying something new could waste time or resources of it. Doesn't work, you know, that is what happened with the Kodak. So Kodak was once upon a time leading company in photography, films, cameras, but it didn't change. So there were ideas that, you know, they had to come into digital photography and later on they could come into mobile phones which had the cameras, but they didn't come into that. They thought that they were doing fine, and there were bureaucratic leaders who rejected these new ideas, and look where it is. Similar thing happened with Nokia, that, you know, they were the pioneers of mobile phones, but they didn't keep up with the changes and the required desires of the customers, and with such leaders, their future got compromised. So employees under this leadership style might not feel as controlled as they would under autocratic leadership, but there is still a lack of freedom in how much people are able to do into their jobs. So this can quickly shut down innovation. They would not be, once the idea is being put to rest, then they would not feel motivated, or they would not try to innovate even, because it is not sure that they'll be encouraged in the company. The idea might be heard or it might not be heard. So the companies who are chasing ambitious goals and quick growth, they might listen to you, but otherwise in a bureaucratic leadership, it would not happen. Now, leadership style assessment. So leaders can carry a mix of all the leadership styles. So it is not that a leader can act only as one. Okay, and what it would depend upon environment, industry, obstacles that they are facing. So at the root of all these styles, according to Taubert and Rook, they call it action logic. So whatever action the leader takes has got a logic behind it, right? Very simple. So these action logics assess how leaders interpret their surroundings and react with their power or safety is challenged. So they can be individualistic, something like, a self-aware, creative and primarily focused on their own actions and developed, as opposed to overall organization's performance, right? So this action logic is exceptionally driven by the desire to exceed personal goals and constantly improving the skills. So a good leader should always you know, you might say about an individualistic person that a good leader should always trust their own intuition over established processes, or it is important to be able to relate to others so that I can communicate complex ideas to them, or I am more comfortable with the progress than sustained success. So all these are individualistic type of leadership style assessment. And then there is a strategist. A strategist are acutely aware of environments in which they operate. They have a deep understanding of the structures and processes that make their business tick, but they are also able to consider these frameworks critically and evaluate what could be improved. So a strategist, you might hear him saying, a good leader should always be able to build a consensus in the divided groups. Or it is important to help develop the organization as a whole, as well as the growth and individual achievements of my direct report. So he's concerned about the growth of the individuals. And then conflict is inevitable, but I am knowledgeable enough about my team's personal and professional relationships to handle the friction. So he is very much capable of handling the conflict because he knows his team. Then there is an alchemist. What is an alchemist? It is the charismatic action logic as the most highly evolved and effective at managing organizational change. So what distinguishes alchemists from other action logics is their unique ability to see the big picture in everything, but also fully understand the need to take details seriously. So an alchemist leader, you know, no employee or department would be overlooked. So you might hear him saying a good leader helps their employees reach their highest potential. So he can bring the highest potential in its subordinates and possess the necessary empathy and moral awareness. It is important to make profound and positive impact on what I am working on. And I have a unique ability to balance short-term needs and long-term goals. So if you have such a kind of a vision, then you are an alchemist. Then opportunist. Opportunists are guided by a certain level of mistrust of others, relying on the facade of control to keep their employees in line. Opportunities tend to regard their bad behavior as legitimate in the cut and thrust of an eye for an eye world. So it was necessary because there is cutthroat competition. It was necessary because my rival is not sensitive. So for them, a good leader should always view others as potential competition to be bested, even if it's at the expense of their professional development. So they are very rivalry-rist in nature. I reserve the right to reject the input of those who question or criticize my ideas. So he's onto his ideas and he doesn't want the critical appraisal of him. Then a diplomat. Unlike the opportunist, the diplomat isn't concerned with the competition or assuming control over situations. Instead, this action logic seeks to cause minimal impact on their organization by conforming to the existing norms and completing their daily tasks with as little friction as possible. So you're very diplomatic, conflict ko avoid karna, you know, you just avoid it. So a good leader should always resist change since it risks cause instability among their direct reports. So he would not be very entertaining towards the change, and it's important to provide the social glue in team situation safely away from conflict. So he would keep the conflict away and tends to thrive in more team oriented or supporting leadership roles. Then an expert. The expert is a pro in their given field, constantly striving to perfect their knowledge of subject and perform to meet their own high expectations. So Ruke and Taubert said that the expert is a talented individual contributor and a source of knowledge for the team. But this action logic does lack something central to many good leaders: emotional intelligence. So now a good leader should prioritize their own pursuit of knowledge over the needs of organization and their direct report. So he is going to prioritize his knowledge needs. And when problem solving with others in the company, my opinion tends to be the correct one. So he feels that I am an expert and people should take from me. So out of all these six, what do you think? Which leader are you? or where you would like to settle yourself as a leader. Think about it. And this was all about leadership styles and the assessments. Thank you so much for listening. We shall get back soon with another topic.